Hello and welcome to the Grand Old History Podcast on both Celtic Fanzine TV and an audio on the Celtic Soul Podcast. So please hit that subscribe and follow button so you never miss an episode. In this episode, I'll be joined again by Celtic historian and author of many, many Celtic books, David Potter, to chat about the life of the Celtic legend, Bertie Auld, who sadly passed away recently and was given a fitting send-off by the Celtic family at Hampden, at Celtic Park and in St Mary's Chapel. Hi, David. You're very welcome back onto the show to pay tribute to Bertie, Celtic legend, Lisbon Lion, Celtic fan, a great character. And I think he was loved by all the fans who met him over the decades.
Yes, indeed he was. And one of the great things about Bertie was he was a very humble man. He was always willing to come to supporters' functions. He came several times to our group in Kirkcaldy and always made himself well known to everybody, and even went out of his way to talk to people like my wife, who has no great interest in football, but came along just because I was there, obviously, and he charmed her because he was really that sort of bloke. He was a charming man and a very lovable man, and really a great Celt. And he loved Celtic till the day that he died. So I've none but praise to say for Bertie Auld.
Now, David, you were lucky enough to have been there. You're of the age where the 60s and the early 70s was a time of great joy for Celtic fans, and you were there to see it. You always talk fondly of the 1965 Cup Final when you say that that's when everything started. You've been on the show before talking about your university days and watching that famous night in Lisbon on TV. So, like, for people of my age who weren't around when Bertie, but met him many times as a fan, as you say, at supporters' functions, and he also sat behind me for a couple of seasons at Celtic Park, and a very enjoyable experience, I have to say. And he was, when he needed to be critical, he was critical. And when he needed to give praise, he gave praise. So just take us back to the career of Bertie, his time at Celtic and those early years.
Yes, I only remember him vaguely in his first few years at Celtic Park, from 1956 to 1961. I think I saw him once or twice. And he played on the left wing, and he was good enough. And I thought there was a great future for this boy at the time. I remember everybody said that. But then, of course, I think he fell a wee bit foul of Bob Kelly and the regime then, and he was transferred to Birmingham City in 1961, just actually in the aftermath of our defeat at Dunfermline in 1961, when Dunfermline, of course, were managed by Jock Stein. Bertie then disappeared off the Celtic radar for 4 years, rather, during which time he appeared in an Intercities Fairs Cup final and won an English League Cup medal with Birmingham City. So he was by no means a failure down there, although Birmingham perhaps weren't the best team in England at the time. And then, of course, he came back in January 1965. Now, there was a connection between Steen coming back and Auld coming back. I don't actually know what happens first. All the participants are dead by now. But my own view is that Jock would never have come back to Celtic Park, or not saying he would never have come back to Celtic Park, he would have been less willing to come back to Celtic Park unless he knew that Bertie Auld was also coming back to Celtic Park. Because I think Jock saw Bertie Auld quite correctly as the man who could win for Celtic the Scottish Cup in the middle of that fairly disastrous 1965 season. And Bertie Auld, when he came back, he played his first game against Hearts at Celtic Park on a rainy day, which I remember. And I remember that day I discovered just how bad the old jungle was for not protecting you. I was as wet in that old jungle as I would have been on the terracing there that day, because the roof was just awful. But anyway, that day he played, the Celtic lost to Hearts, and then Steen officially came back at the end of January, 1st of February. And that was when the announcement was made. In fact, I think Steen had been making a few decisions for Celtic at the time when he was officially manager of Hibs. And one of the decisions, the key one, I think, was that, well, there was two key ones, but he basically moved Celtic from a 2-3-5 team, you know, fullbacks, halfbacks, and five forwards, the traditional Scottish and English formation, into a 4-2-4 formation, with Bertheol moving from the left wing to the left of the midfield. And at the same time, of course, he pulled Bobby Murdoch back from the inside right position to the right half, so that by the time Celtic won the European Cup, they were playing a 4-2-4 formation with Murdoch and Auld in midfield. And frankly, you couldn't get two better midfielders than these two. But I think the big difference that Bertie Auld made to Celtic was that he gave them some, what I call, devil. He gave them a wee bit of needle. Previously, the players had been good enough, but didn't quite have the match-winning ability that they needed. And Bertheold produced that because of his confidence, because of his good play, the way he could rile the opposition, and the way that he could bring on youngsters as well, the way they could bring out the best in other members of the team. By this time, of course, Bertie was older than most of them, and he was a great help to the to people like Billy McNeil, I always thought, because I think he was a man who just inspired confidence in the team. And of course, the 1965 season, what was left of the 1965 season, saw really some pretty awful Celtic games in the league, but they did win the important games, the one that they had to, in the Scottish Cup. They beat Kilmarnock, they beat Motherwell after a replay, and it was Bertie Auld who organised the rescue of the first game in the semi-final, when it looked as if, Celtic were going to lose to Motherwell. And of course, his contribution to the Cup final itself that year was just absolutely immense, with his two goals, that one header that hit the bar, and Charlie Gallagher hit the bar, and Bertie was waiting for it to head it home, and then the second equalising goal with a brilliant 1-2 with Bobby Lennox, and Bertie Auld was the man who won the Scottish Cup for Celtic in 1965. I know Billy McNeil gets praise for the wonderfully headed goal, and I wouldn't take anything away from Billy McNeil at all, but I think that the main force was probably Bertie Auld, plus Bobby Murdoch in his new role as right half rather than inside right. And all this was down to Steen, and I'm fairly convinced in my own mind that Steen and Auld talked about these things even before either of them were officially back at Celtic Park in that awful midwinter of 1964 to 1965.
And you mentioned Bobby Murdoch there, his midfield partnership, that Jock, he saw something in these two players to move them. They became a great midfield duo, so successful. Where did they sit, those two players sit in history as, you know, partnerships in the middle of the park for Celtic?
I would have to say up at the very top. I mean, you can't argue against that. It's difficult to compare them because team formations do change, and they're actually quite fluid, the team formations. And I must say, as a youngster, who maybe didn't understand the dynamics of the football field as well as I could have, because I'd never actually played the game, didn't realise that Celtic were actually playing 4-2-4. I was convinced they were playing the traditional 2-3-5. Until I watched a game once with a good friend of mine who'd actually played professional football, semi-professional football for East Fife. And we watched the game and he said to me, you know, what Celtic are doing, they're playing a 4-2-4 formation. They've got Auld in the left midfield, Murdoch in the right midfield, and they actually are 4-2-4. And of course he was right. And I may say the 4-2-4 formation was a bit of a dirty term in Scotland in the mid-1960s because it was associated with European teams who played defensive football when they played Scottish teams in Europe and so on. And it was a long time before the formation 4-2-4 became respectable. But certainly the Celtic team that won in Lisbon was definitely playing a 4-2-4 formation, albeit a very, very fluid 4-2-4 formation, because part of the thing was that the players were all very, very well trained indeed, for which we must give a lot of credit to Steen himself and to Neil Mochen, who was indeed the trainer.
Yeah, and where do, like you say, they sit at the top of the pile when it comes to, you know, midfield partnerships. You know, moving forward over the years, have you seen anyone that, you know, that came close to them? Or were they just that good?
They were that good. There's quite a few who've come close to them. I mean, I always thought that Paul McStay on his game was very good. And the current team, I think Callum McGregor is approaching that level. I wouldn't say he's quite as good as that. I know it's different team formations and so on, but I've always enjoyed watching Callum McGregor. Possibly, I feel less so about David Turnbull. I feel that David Turnbull perhaps has the potential to become as good as either of these two, but hasn't quite reached it yet. You get a lot of disappointments with David sometimes, but Callum McGregor approaches the level of Murdoch and Auld in midfield. And I would certainly put Paul McStay in the same bracket as Murdoch and Auld. The problem with Paul McStay, of course, is there weren't enough great players round about him. Paul stood out like a beacon in a team of, I wouldn't say they were mediocre, I wouldn't go as far as that, but they weren't as good as what the 1960s team was that Bertie Auld and Bobby Murdoch took charge of in the late 1960s.
Yeah, and Bertie was off the pitch as well. As you said, he attended so many supporters' functions. And back in the day, it was quite common for players to be told at the end of a match, this is where you're going tonight for your supporters' function, and that could be up to Aberdeen, or it could be a local in Glasgow. It could be further afield. So, Bertie was part of that, I suppose, community that, you know, players and fans, and that team would have trained in Barrowfield. They would have eaten the cafes around Celtic Park. They would have been they would have socialised in the city. So they would have been very, I suppose, approachable, which is not so much now with the players. And when I think back to when the news broke that Bertie had died, I got a text from a friend, and he said, "Don't say anything because it's not officially announced yet." And then the news had broken before it was officially announced that this great legend of Celtic had sadly passed away. But what struck me over the next couple of days was the amount of young people putting up pictures with him on social media. And this was this was from babies, you know, right through up to 18-year-olds who would never have even heard of Bertie, only for, you know, a father or somebody said, "Look, get a picture there." But they had grown now, they were grown men, and these lovely pictures were put up from over the years, and the stories that was with the pictures. And what I took from all the stories was the love the Celtic fans and the Celtic family had for Bertie, but also the love that he had for them and the time. You know, nothing was a problem. He would pose for, he loved being Bertie Auld.
Yes, he did, yes. And the story about him in the tunnel at Lisbon starting singing the Celtic song, I mean, that's true, and that's very typical of Bertie Auld. And I also like the story that Charlie Gallagher told me, that Jock Steen apparently had once, in an off-the-cuff remark, said that he didn't think that Bertie Auld and Charlie Gallagher should be in the same team, because they were both similar players. They were both ball winners and ball players, and we needed the other types of players. And Bertie, of course, obviously disagreed with that, as indeed did Charlie. And about a quarter of an hour after they'd won the Dunfermline game in 1965, and they were in the dressing room, and normally you were frightened to go near Jock Steen, of course, but the two of them went up, Bertie Auld leading them, and they both had their Scottish Cup winners' medals round their neck. And Bertie said to Jock, "Hey, boss, I thought you said that Charlie and I couldn't play in the same team together. And he says, well, the SFA seem to disagree because they've given both of us medals for playing football, for winning a cup. And apparently, Jock looked at Bertie and then had to laugh. I mean, he would not have laughed if they hadn't just won the cup. If they'd lost that day, he would not have laughed. But apparently, he laughed at that point. And Jock got to realise just what sort of man Bertie was. You know, and he exploited that, and he used Bertie as much as he could, as a joker, as a an encourager, as a cheerleader in many ways. And imagine the Lisbon Lions and the team of the late 60s without Bertie Auld is just impossible, because Bertie Auld was really the man who, on the park, along with Bobby Murdoch and along with all the rest of them, because there were no weak links there, but Bertie Auld was the man who really made it all happen. For maybe social reasons rather than just football playing reasons, if you know what I mean, because he was the man who kept everybody happy.
Yeah, I'm smiling here because I'm just thinking of stuff in the back of my mind, just speaking of stories that I've heard about, like he sat behind me for a couple of seasons, and he kicked every ball, and he spoke to everyone around him, and he told them his opinion.
Oh yes, he did. Yes,
he would tip you on the shoulder if you went, if you didn't hear him the first time, he tipped you on the shoulder to tell, like, so you acknowledged what he said. And when we weren't doing too good, now he was critical, and when we were doing well, he was very complimentary. But he loved the 67 minute. When the lights would go on the phones everyone would start singing. Okay. He was very proud of that. And I remember at the start, when that started, and I remember one day there was a tribute from the Green Brigade. I think they got fined for it when they put this big, huge flag, covered the whole area. And then a couple of lads came out with ballyclavas on and the flares. And it was just, to watch from where we were sitting was a spectacle. And he was so excited that day, and so grateful and so thankful that him and his teammates would be remembered like that. And it was a very special moment. At the time, I didn't think so much of it, but now when I think back, and he's passed, that he knew how much young people and old people who were lucky enough to see him, but young people knew his legacy and his team's legacy and what they had achieved. And it's just a lovely, it's a lovely thought to have of, for all these players, and sadly a lot of them are no longer with us, but that there's so much still thought of them.
Yes.
By the fans, and many of those fans way too young to have ever seen Bertie.
Yeah, well, that of course is part of the Celtic tradition, because I mean, I do remember the Lisbon Lions. I didn't go to Lisbon. I was too young. I was a student. I couldn't go to Lisbon, but I saw them in the Scottish Cup final that year of 1967, and of course 1965. And I had of course been brought up on the Celts of a previous generation. I'd been told all about Jimmy McGrory and Patsy Gallagher by my father, who in turn had been told by his father all about Alec McNair and Jimmy Young and Jimmy Quinn and people like that. So it's right that that should happen. It's right that the Celtic should keep their history going. And I'm so glad to hear what you're saying, that Bertie was so proud of it, because he was just simply that sort of man.
Yeah, and I think you deserve kudos and applause as well, because you've just named the players that your dad had kept you informed about and told you stories about. Mm-hmm. And you also talked about your grandfather passing down stories to your dad, which was then passed down onto you. But you've passed all them stories on in your many, many books to us and to generations to follow. So, David, for what you do for the Celtic fans, we thank you.
All right, that's much appreciated. I'm very glad to hear you say that, Andrew. Very glad. But I'm proud to continue being a Celt. I must say it's very much part of one's life. I mean, I think it was very much part of Bertie Auld's life as well. Just being a Celt, and I think that with all due respect to people who support other teams, I don't actually think they quite appreciate what Celtic mean to so many people. I mean, I also support teams like Forfar Athletic, Raith Rovers, Newcastle United, Middlesbrough, a lot of teams like that I've got a soft spot for. But it's nothing like what it means being part of Celtic Football Club, even though just being a part means that the chap that pays his money or gets his season ticket and goes to the turnstiles every week, it's a great thing to be part of. It has its pains, of course. It always has done and always will do. But it also has its great moments of triumph as well. And it really is, it's a great thing to be part of.
It certainly is, David. Bertie, you mentioned that Bertie had attended your supporters club's function, and he came over for one of our supporters clubs. I'm in the club called St. Margaret's, and mm-hmm. he came over, and I think it was him and Tosh McKinley came over together, and Tosh was mm-hmm. doing the after dinner speaking, because he's probably the best out there. Tosh does a great after dinner. But then Bertie got on stage and he was interviewed by, uh-huh. by, there was a local journalist, a radio journalist, broadcaster was the MC on the night, and Bertie obviously, you know, Bertie ended up interviewing him, I think, because he was just so humorous, and but he was just lovely. And then the next day we were having lunch before he travelled back, and he had us all around the table, and he had the salt and the pepper and the knives and forks, and this was the lines, and he was telling us where to go, and he was telling us where the team was going wrong now.
But he
was the salt, and Bobby Mullig was the pepper in the middle of the table, and it was just one of them things. And I just remember Tosh McKinley couldn't keep a straight face with just having lunch. Like, you know, he was just such a great, great character. David, like as you say, that he truly loved the club. But look, before we wrap up, will you give us another story about Bertie?
Yes, indeed. Yes, it's the story that he himself told. I don't know whether your viewers or listeners will have heard of this one, but it's the story that he told about the quiz between Celtic and Rangers supporters. They decided, you know, because they were basically friends, they got their wee quiz together, and so it was Celtic supporters versus Rangers supporters, and the quizmaster was there with his dinner suit and a neutral red tie and things like this, and he said, right, here's the first question. Who was the first British team to win the European Cup? And Celtic guys go, Celtic, right? Who is the first team in Scotland to win 9 league titles in a row? Celtic. And the Rangers guys were beginning to, wait a minute, what was some question about us? All right, okay, here's one for you. Who was the Rangers player who scored the goal in the League Cup final? Press the button. Hey, wait a minute. What League Cup final? Quizmaster says, the one that you lost 7-1. That was Bertie Auld that told this story several times. You know?
Brilliant, brilliant.
So that's what I'll remember about Bertie Auld, combining all his many other estimable qualities with humour, and very much a Glasgow person. You know, Glasgow humour, in which there is no real basic malice. You know, that I've often said that, contrary to opinion, to what seems sometimes, that there actually is quite a good relationship goes on in Glasgow between Celtic and Rangers supporters. Some of them, not I know that. But I think Bertie's a bit like that. I mean, I don't think Rangers supporters would really hate Bertie Auld. You know, I don't think he's a man that you could very readily hate, even though, I mean... We could mention several on the Rangers side. I'm quite prepared to. I'll not mention any names. Bertie Auld, even if you're a Rangers supporter, would not come into that character. He was a great Celt, and he was a great Glasgow character.
He certainly was. David, thank you so much for joining us again on the Grand Isle History Podcast. And for further listening from David, check out David's tribute to Bertie's teammate, Charlie Gallagher. And you can also hear David on previous episodes of the Celtic Soul podcast. And he also appeared on our Lockdown Celtic AM podcast, available here on Celtic Fanzine TV and across all podcast platforms on the Celtic Soul podcast. David, thank you very much. And thank you very much to Bertie Auld for the memories both on and off the park.
Yes, indeed. Thank you very much, Bertie Auld, RIP. And thank you very much, Andrew Moore.
David, thank you so much.